So your background is in peatland and desertification research, but you have for many years now become increasingly interested in research impact, to such an extent, in fact, that you co-founded and now lead Fast Track Impact, a company which specialises in providing training to researchers in how to increase their impact. What inspired you to go down this path?
Well, I started out as a student, actually. I was studying tropical environmental science in Aberdeen University, and there was this amazing lecturer that totally inspired me. And she was standing in front of me in class one day doing her thing, and I was just like, wow, this is amazing. I want your job. I want to do exactly what you're doing right there. And so I went down the path of doing a PhD, trying to do that whole academic thing, and discovered this whole thing called research that is actually a big part of the academic's life, and discovered that in addition to inspiring students, that actually I could make an impact through the environmental research that that I did. Increasingly, I started to actually study why it was that certain things worked and why other things didn't work in terms of working with stakeholders and publics and stuff around the environment. As a result of that, I realised that, well, actually, I can make so much of an impact in terms of the work I do on deserts or on peat bogs, but actually, if I could distill what I've learned about how it is that we generate new ideas and knowledge that can make the world a better place and turn that into a training course, then the multiplier effect of training others how they can make a difference could actually enable me to have an order of magnitude greater impact on the world than I could otherwise have had.
I know that an idea that is close to your heart is two-way knowledge exchange. What exactly do you mean by that?
Yeah, for me, ultimately, it's an attitude of spirit. It's about the humility to accept that no matter how clever you might be, no matter how many years of research you might have done on that topic, that you might not be right, and there might be another way of looking at it, and that we have to actually listen to the people who are interested in our work, who might benefit from our work. And by listening, we can actually do more relevant work that can answer their questions more effectively. And we can actually learn stuff ourselves. And together, I believe that the know-how of people out there in the world who are actually doing stuff with our research and the know-why of researchers can actually make more of a difference than either of us trying to tackle huge challenges on our own.
So impact has become a bit of a buzzword for researchers and for funding bodies, but it is a difficult to define concept. What, in your eyes, is impact?
In simple terms, it is, for me, the good that researchers can do in the world. I think there are two quite powerful concepts that you can then use to define this further. The first is that if we want to do good through our research, we need to try and do something that is actually significant, so not something fairly low level, but to try and actually do something that really does make a difference. And the second concept then is reach. So yeah, I made a difference, I've saved someone's life as a result of my research. How now can I take that and expand that and roll that out so that I can actually now save millions of people's lives instead?
There is increasing emphasis on researchers to be able to actively demonstrate impact. Where is that pressure coming from?
I think it's increasingly coming from the public. Increasingly, we are living in a society, in a world where there are competing demands on public money. And a large proportion of research is funded by the public through government grants. And I think that it is only reasonable, only right, that the public wants to know what its money is being spent on. Now, that doesn't mean that we can't do blue skies research. There is and should always be a really valuable, important place for that. But there's no reason why we can't communicate the wonder, the amazement of that blue skies research. And I think there are so many challenges out there in the world, and there are so many researchers with big brains who could actually potentially solve some of these problems, that it is right that we do what we can to work together as a research community to try and actually tackle some of these problems with the money that the public has given us.
And this is an area that can be quite challenging for researchers. Are there certain areas where it is more difficult to demonstrate impact?
I think most researchers will say, you know what, hey, you guys have got it easy, it's a lot harder for me. And I think in most areas there are challenges, but I do think that some areas are more challenging than others. And I think there are certain disciplinary areas, certain topic areas which are challenging, either because of huge time lags between when you do the research and when it would naturally then have an impact. Attribution. So yeah, you did some research, but a bunch of other people did some cool stuff, and there were all these other external factors that went on, and actually really how much of that impact was down to you. And ideology. And I think that probably when you're trying to achieve policy impacts, all three of these then come into play, and that can really be challenging. Sadly, a lot of government policy is not evidence-based. And although that is frustrating for many researchers, that is because this is actually a policy-making process where ministers, politicians are making decisions based on ideology and on morals and on principles which may or may not agree with the research. And as a result, no matter how great your research is, it may just not be possible to actually get it through the door in any sensible time period, be able to actually get the credit for it, and actually make a difference with people in power who may think very differently to you and may interpret your work very differently to the way you would interpret it.
You've worked with over 80% of the Russell Group universities in the UK and other universities across Northern Europe. What do the researchers that you work with learn from the training you provide?
I think it's two things. It's a heart and a mind for impact. I think for me the biggest battle is a battle for hearts at the moment, which is to say that this is something which is important and is actually worthy of doing as a researcher. And I think that for many researchers, when you ask them, why do you do what you do? Why are you a researcher? The answer is not actually very often, I want to make a difference. For most researchers, they went into this because they simply are curious. They never grew up and stopped asking why questions, and that's fantastic. And for me, it's about connecting all of those motives, whether it's curiosity, whether it's about leaving a legacy, social standing, or even career and promotion and these kind of things, and connecting all of that stuff through to impact so we can understand why actually engaging with impact will enable you to ask questions that fascinate you, that you never dreamt you would ever be asking. Once you've won that battle of the hearts and people actually get, well, yeah, this is something that I really want to do, then it's a battle for the mind, which is to say, well, okay, I might want to do this, but where the hell am I going to get the time to do this? Look at the number of emails I've got to answer, all these pressures on my time. And for me, I named my spin-out company Fast Track Impact because I believe it is possible to do things which are effective in terms of impact, but that do not take you all of your weekends and your evenings. It is possible, I believe, to do some of these things remarkably time efficiently.
Are there common concerns or difficulties that you hear in the training sessions?
Yeah, I think the thing that most people worry about are probably the two most valuable commodities as a researcher. It's your time and it's your reputation. And so people are concerned that this is going to take way more time than they've got, given the demands that they have. And at the same time, that they're going to be pushed beyond their comfort zone, and they're going to do or say things that are going to get them into trouble or that they're going to regret later on. And we've all heard stories of people whose words have been manipulated in the media and people who've lost their jobs over a tweet, for example. And I would argue it is not without risk, but it's a case of balancing, well, how much do I want to actually make a difference? And how can I step out there in a way which is low risk in terms of both my time and my reputation? And I believe it is possible to make a huge difference and to engage with a range of different people in ways that should risk neither of those things.
Could you give me an example of a successful impact strategy?
Yeah, I think I would describe the work I've done on peat bogs as something that has worked for me that I can share from my own experience, where we wanted to restore damaged peat bogs using carbon markets. So we'd done all of the natural science to demonstrate that this was possible, and one of our papers ended up getting into a newspaper, and someone phoned me up, and her job was to actually restore peat bogs. And so she was like, hey, so I've heard about this great new way of getting money to do this. How can you get me access to these carbon markets? And I was like, well, yeah, maybe call us back in 10 years' time and we might have worked that bit of the story out. But so instead of calling back in 10 years' time, I actually called about quite quickly after that and said, actually, there's this funding call come out. We'd like to collaborate with you. Maybe we can work together to solve this problem. And what that meant was that she then gave us access to networks of people who were in this world grappling with these problems, who were able to then help us to keep our feet on the ground as a team of researchers and develop the kind of evidence that was actually needed to be able to create this kind of market and make this stuff happen. So at the end of the day, we did an analysis of the whole policy and practice network of who was talking to who and who was using the research that we were doing, and we discovered that there was one organisation, a charity, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, that was by far and away the most influential. So I made it my job to work with them. I eventually became their research manager, which gave me access to their networks and a lot of power and credibility in that world. And as a result of that, eventually IUCN then became the owner of a new code, a form of policy mechanism that for the first time is now enabling businesses to invest in peat bogs to do good things for the environment at the same time as achieve their goals as a company. So it is working. It took us probably about 11 years since that initial phone call to when we actually launched this policy mechanism and made this thing happen. But from the beginning, working with the stakeholders and the people who actually needed answers to the questions so that we, as researchers, asked the right questions and could come up with answers that would genuinely be useful. I can go even further with that one if you want, for something interesting. It's a slightly... is it a bizarre story in that we reached a blockage where we couldn't get to the level that we wanted because we'd gone to corporate social responsibility officers, and it turned out they didn't have any power in the corporate world, so we had to go to chief execs. Mm-hmm. And because our networks didn't extend far enough, we employed this fixer guy who basically for his half price charity rate of £500 a day opened an address book to us. And so he was related through marriage to Benedict Cumberbatch and either related to or friends with half of the royal family and all these chief execs and politicians and all the rest of it. And all of a sudden, we started to actually make progress. But we were monitoring what we were doing and had a really systematic strategy for getting to where we wanted to. And when we reached a dead end, we just tried something different. And that was us kind of going to kind of the nuclear button of last resort, yeah. But it actually worked.
And why is outsourcing to consultants important at times?
So I think the problem is that people like me, certainly in my generation, we weren't ever taught how to do this stuff. We were taught how to generate knowledge, not how to disseminate or share or co-produce knowledge with people. So for a lot of us, we're going fairly far beyond our comfort zones. And it doesn't come naturally, it doesn't come easy. We're not all naturals at this stuff. And to me, the great news is that most of our research funders want us to do really high profile, slick, professional comms work around our research. And there are people out there who will do this stuff for us. So you don't need to hassle yourself with it. You don't need the risk and the nervousness and do something a bit shoddy. You can actually pay someone else to do it, and less hassle, less time, and a better job. I was working with the research councils recently in the UK who fund much of our research, and they were saying, how much do we persuade researchers to actually put budget to the stuff and take it seriously? Because we want them to be paying professionals to do a professional job of this stuff. And even when we ask them to give us around 10% of your budget for this, they'll give us between 4 and 5%. And there is this message that we need to get through that actually there are an army of consultants and freelancers and other people out there with specific skills that can do a far better job than us. And it takes the pressure off us as academics.
So do you think it's important that researchers allocate a budget for professional activity when they're applying for project funding?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think the key thing is that you need to plan for this though. So you need to have a clear idea in your head of exactly what impact you want to achieve. in clear, specific, measurable terms so that you can work out what activities you need to then do to achieve that impact with which audiences, stakeholders, publics. And once you've got to that point in your thinking, you can then start to say, right, okay, it would be really useful to have a filming team and a photographer and a designer and a science writer who can then make all this stuff happen. And I think that actually makes you more competitive in terms of the grants that you're putting in, because it is clear you're serious about this stuff and you've actually thought it through, and your funders know that if they give you that funding, then they're going to get their money's worth out of this. It's going to be really good value for them, and it will show their funded research in the best light possible.
A lot of what we've discussed today is contained in your book, The Research Impact Handbook. This, as the title suggests, contains lots of practical advice for researchers who are hoping to increase the impact of their research. Can you tell me about the process of writing the book?
It was quite fun, actually, because I thought, you know what, for once, I'm not going to write something in the usual academic style. As an academic, I myself have to read dry, challenging stuff on a daily basis. I actually do quite enjoy it, but it's hard work. And so I wanted something that would be really easy to read. So it was quite a creative process for me writing it. But fundamentally, this was a way of me summarising a decade's worth of my own research into stakeholder participation, public engagement, knowledge exchange and impact, and to then integrate that with my understanding of the latest research from across the disciplines in this particular area, so that we had something which was evidence-based, and that was based on my own lived experience as well, actually walking the walk, talking the talk, as I have done this research over the years in my environmental work, but that was at the same time accessible and practical for researchers to use.
I really enjoyed how open you are in the introduction, talking about how, despite a long list of achievements, you still feel nervous when presenting to various different stakeholders. Do you think that's something that ever goes away?
Yeah, I hear it does, but sadly this isn't my experience. So most of my colleagues are like, yeah, it gets easier, you just have to practice. And I have the fortunate thing of when I do public speaking, I manage to hide it to such an extent that no one has any idea. I mean, doing an interview like this is actually fairly nerve-wracking for me. I felt quite nervous about this, but apparently you'll tell me. It doesn't show. There you go. So I've no idea how I do that, which is it's a handy thing. Yeah. I've done multiple things which have just absolutely terrified the hell out of me. And I think the answer is just to say, you know what, if your motive for doing this is right and you're passionate about why it is that you're doing it, then something else takes over and you just say, you know what, despite the fear, I'm doing this anyway. And once you get into your stride, it all happens. But my first ever public thing was a lecture. My first ever lecture actually had a panic attack. It went very badly. I've had a long litany of stories of things where I've burned, and it's crashed and burned. I just keep doing it because I believe it's important, so.
In the handbook, you mention the open access model, but you do caution that available research isn't necessarily accessible research. Why is the language that we use to discuss science so important?
Yeah, so there's something quite tribal about science. We create these tribes and we emphasise our difference, and we do that primarily through language. A lot of it is acronyms, a lot of it is just specific bits of technical jargon and academies that is understood by people who are like us in our discipline, but by no one else. And it is language, I believe, that creates and retains the barriers between disciplines. And that's okay. I think that monodisciplinary research is important. We need to do that. But for many of the kinds of questions that we need to answer that will have the biggest impact in the world, typically these kinds of real-world problems, they do not respect disciplinary boundaries. And for that reason, we need to be able to take down those walls. And I believe that the most powerful way we can take down those walls is by learning to actually write even our academic work in academic journals and books in as plain language as we possibly can, that can be understood by researchers from different disciplines as well as people outside academia. Now, not everyone from outside academia is going to be able to access or will want to read stuff in an academic journal. And there is, of course, a place for then turning this into blogs, microblogs, things like Twitter, working with professional writers to turn this into briefing notes and all the rest of it. But fundamentally, if we cannot communicate our work in ways that actually is understandable by people, it doesn't matter that it's on the internet, it's still gobbledygook.
One area you draw attention to in the handbook is social media, and we're all aware of high-profile scientists such as Bill Nye the Science Guy or Professor Brian Cox, who have managed to engage vast swathes of the public in discussions around science using social media, particularly Twitter, but other platforms as well. For those researchers with less public profiles, how can social media be important to them and their research generally?
I think the first thing I would say is that it doesn't have to. I think that there's a huge pressure that a lot of academics are feeling that I have to do this because everyone else is doing it, or I'll be somehow branded as some kind of dinosaur. And I think that the first thing to say is do social media if you've got a reason to do it. And I think that there are reasons to do it, but there is risk associated with it, and you need to be aware of that risk. I think that the lowest risk way of doing this is simply actively curating your digital footprint, which may not be anything to do with social media whatsoever. It's about having a Google Scholar profile, so your work is easily accessible. So when people do a Google Scholar search, your name is hyperlinked, they can see the rest of your papers. It's keeping various profiles up to date, making sure that they're professional, that you're findable easily. And for many researchers, this is then, for them, a way of getting up-to-date news from their discipline, about research funding, about collaborators, engaging in conferences, etc. And to do that, you can engage in social media. You don't need to actually put out any content whatsoever. You can be what's known as a lurker, but someone who's just kind of watching and reading. And you can be more effective as a researcher without really taking any of the risks of actually engaging fully in social media. I think if you want to then take it to the next level and actually engage in social media in a way that derives impact, then typically you need to be influential. In social media world, numbers equals influence, and there are very simple, easy ways that you can grow your following. So I grew one account that I needed to be influential on by over 30,000 followers in a year. In 20 minutes per day, and in that time I was actually saving myself time in my working day. There are ways that you can do this that doesn't mean that you get addicted to it, that doesn't mean that you've got this on all the time interrupting your work. It can be efficient, and once you've got that influence, then it's about turning online influence into offline impact, so that these are now relationships, and relationships that can go from social media onto email, onto phone, Skype, face-to-face, and actually now in the real world making a difference. Some people say, well, yeah, that's fine for you, Mark, you're a professor and you've got some profile or whatever, but this works for pretty much anyone. I've got a PhD student and she has started up a knowledge brokerage company alongside her PhD, and so she needs to grow her following so that she can build her business. And so she is a PhD student, she isn't particularly well known, she uses exactly the same technique as me, and she grows by on average 40 to 50 new followers per day, and she's been doing this for a few months now. She just passed 7,000 followers, which is more than most people. So there are techniques that are commonly widely used across the world for lots of different types of endeavour. Researchers can use those techniques as well. You don't have to be particularly influential, famous, well known to use them, and that is one of the things that is great about social media. You don't have to already be well known, you can become influential through this. It's a very egalitarian kind of online society. Right, so first of all, you need to be fairly disciplined. So if you have an addictive personality, this might not be for you, it might not work. But assuming you don't, then I keep quite careful tabs on it. So every now and then I will do an audit, I will download an app tracker to find out how long am I spending on this. So I now manage 6 Twitter accounts, including one for my school in my university, and I on average spend about 50 minutes per day. The reason that this actually saves me time is that I used to spend around about 80, 90 minutes per day on news. I now get all of that news through Twitter, and that includes the mainstream news, but also stuff that's more relevant to me. And in that 50 minutes, in addition to getting my daily fix of news, I'm also then doing all of that outreach across those 6 different accounts. So I get an extra half an hour or whatever it is per day, which I can do what I want with. The way that I do it is, first of all, having a very clear strategy for each of those Twitter accounts. What is it that I'm trying to achieve? Why am I on social media? And I think the first thing to say is, you know, if the audience that you're trying to influence is not on social media or they're on a different platform, then you're wasting your time. So have a clear idea of who you're trying to reach and for what purpose, and pursue that persistently. And you're then trying to understand how that audience works, what makes them tick, what they're interested in. So you're now doing stuff that really adds value to them. You're thinking about ways to make your tweets and other posts engaging, so people actually sit up and take listen, sit up and take notice. So there's evidence that suggests you're 30-something percent more likely to get engagement if you've got a photograph with your tweet or a video. But also think about your wording and what might be perhaps something that is perhaps a little bit more personal, or not personal to you, but personal to the other person that kind of connects with them, or unexpected, that makes people think, huh, that's really interesting, I'll share that. Or some kind of call to action that will make people do something as a result of what you're putting out there. I don't think as an academic you can say much of value in 140 characters, so I think the majority of your tweets should have a link to a blog or a video or a paper or something where you can go into more depth. And then finally, you need to curate your tweets and have a follow strategy. So I have an approach which is kind of opposite to what most people teach you should do on Twitter. So most people tell you that you should say the same thing lots of different times, at least twice a day, because people will typically only go on the platform for a short period of time. They won't see everything that has been posted. And that takes quite a lot of time. Yeah, you can automate it. I personally don't automate my tweets because I want it to be more personal and people feel like there's a real person behind it. But that's just my own choice. So once I've tweeted something valuable, I've spent a bit of time on that, I want to extract as much value as I can out of that tweet. So what I will do now is I'll put it out, yes, at a time when I know my audience is there. So for my Fast Track Impact account, I'm targeting academics, support staff, researchers. They are typically active between 7 and 9 a.m. Monday to Friday. I'll tweet at that relevant time so I get as many people seeing it as possible. But then, rather than repeating the same thing again and again, I'm now putting those tweets in front of as many people as possible. So what I do is I curate my last three tweets. So I make sure that the last three things that are left on my account are three things which are good. And I'm measuring good by amount of engagement. So on that account, if I haven't got 10 retweets and or likes within 24 hours, it's not good enough. I'll delete it rather than leave it there if it's not getting that message across. And then I'm putting those three tweets in front of as many people as possible. Twitter did research quite a while ago now that said people make a follow decision in less than 10 seconds based on the last three things you said. So I'm now putting my account in front of people by going to a similar account and following everyone who follows that account. So in the case of Fast Track Impact, the only other account that tweets about impact is the London School of Economics Impact blog, LSE Impact blog. So if you follow that, I assume that you're probably an academic, you're probably looking for content about impact, and you'll get a follow from me at some point. I view that as an invitation, which you can accept or not. Once you find out that I exist, you see what I do, then you may or may not follow. What most people then do is they like what they see in those last three tweets enough that they will retweet at least one of those. And so I'll go through and in a couple of minutes I'll have followed a few hundred people. Just, I'm not even looking at who they are, just whoever has followed this account over the last couple of days, great. I'll go and look, and actually the people who've then followed me as a result, half of them are people who I just followed, who saw, hey, that looks interesting, that's exactly what I'm looking for. The other half are actually their followers because they retweeted it, they liked what they saw in the retweet enough that they thought, huh, I wonder who's saying that. They looked at the profile, saw the last three tweets, and they followed. They retweeted some of it, and so it kind of goes on like that. And so it is possible with a very small amount of time to do that. Now, you get a whole lot of issues coming up at that point that you need to get around in terms of your timeline is now gobbledygook. You need to read from lists or have an account that you read from and an account that you're promoting. from any academics, this doesn't work if you're promoting your own account. It feels very egotistical. I don't personally feel comfortable doing this for my own account. I do it for my project accounts and my institutional accounts. And I think for women as well, it is quite a useful tip. The evidence again says that women are more likely to get harassed on Twitter as a platform. And if you are tweeting from an institutional account, then you're much less likely to get targeted. And if you do, it's easier to take than if it's more personal.
If we take the UK as an example, a lot has already been done to raise the profile of impact and to put it at the front of the research agenda. How successful has this been so far?
It's hard to say. I think it's quite mixed. So I think if you compare where the UK is in terms of our awareness as a society of the impact that research makes, our awareness as an academy of the impact of our research, I think we are streets ahead of any other nation in the world, because decisions have been made to actually go out and audit and measure and work out what this stuff is and how it's all working. So in that sense, we're doing really well. But I think there's a bit of a bittersweet victory here in that because this has been mainstreamed so effectively from the top down, from the government, from the funders, etc., that there's a sense amongst many of the academics that actually this is something that we're being told to do, and actually what are the motives behind this, and do we really feel comfortable about this, and is this actually a step too far in terms of what I should be expected to do for my research? And the danger is that there becomes a backlash to this isn't something which is a really grassroots movement that comes from within the academy and people like me and others like me who actually believe genuinely that whatever your motives are, whether you are intrinsically motivated by impact or not, there are fundamentally good reasons why we should all be motivated to be engaged with this kind of thing. I think that's what we need to make sure that this is a grassroots movement and that it doesn't get derailed by some of the kind of the policy statements and decisions that are made from on high, which become challenging for researchers to deal with. I think even more concerning is that there can be unintended consequences where researchers figure, well, hey, now there's some extrinsic motivation that will get me a promotion or get me some funding, and it becomes a tick box exercise. And I've certainly talked to people in the policy community who have said, you know what, there's a real issue with academics phoning me up to try and have an impact on me. And actually, I'm too busy for random people to have impacts on me. There are certain things that I need, and there are people I trust that I'll go to, and actually, the rest of you, can you just leave me alone, thanks? And there's a real danger that we actually make a bad name for ourselves if we do this badly. So for me, this is about getting to the real heart of the impact agenda. And for me, at that heart are relationships and trust. And if we keep our eyes fixed on that, then I believe that we can actually retain this as a vibrant, living, grassroots movement of people who actually genuinely want to make the world a better place.
Looking forward, you're launching Fast Track Impact magazine later this year. What are you hoping that's going to provide for researchers?
Yeah, so I'm lucky enough, for the first time ever, with my research impact handbook, I went down a self-publishing route, which has been a revelation to me in many ways. The great thing is that every 1,000 copies that I sell, I can make little tweaks. So if there's a little bit of updating, then I can do that. And I will be releasing the second edition of that in April this year. But actually, it's a remarkably fast-moving field, and I'm constantly reading stuff and writing stuff and blogging about stuff. It occurred to me that actually, rather than kind of drip feeding these things through the odd random blog in various different places on different platforms, that actually by collecting all of this new information in one place, that could actually be more useful and add more value to people. So that's how it started, but now I've created a pilot issue and I've put it out to the community, and people are coming back and saying, this is amazing, there's like a magazine for us, people who do impact type stuff and are interested in this kind of thing, and this can be a bit of a community. And so now I am actually inviting a few people to contribute their own articles, their own views, and going out through social media to get people to contribute their own ideas. It's turning into something bigger and hopefully more useful. That can be, I hope, a meeting of minds for people who want to understand what is the latest evidence, what are the latest tips, tricks, techniques that you can use to do this more effectively, more efficiently, and we can all hopefully learn together.
For young researchers who are at the start of their careers, what advice would you have for them if they're hoping to increase the impact of their research?
Yeah, so I think it's never too early to start, and I think you don't have to be put off by the crazy big dreams of I'm going to finish my PhD and have a spin-out company, or I'm going to change government policy or whatever. You are typically working on a fairly small, narrow field of endeavour, and that's fine. But have a think to yourself, what could I do that might add value? And for me, the first step is to simply go out there and start asking questions, whether that's reaching out via social media, talking to people who are working in similar areas to you, whether that's just other researchers who are more applied than you, or whether it's stakeholders or publics, and finding out what really gets people excited, what's keeping people awake at night in relation to my work. And ask yourself the question, is there something I could do that wouldn't take too much extra work, that could, just by asking an extra question, framing my work in a slightly different way, that could add value to these audiences. What I often find from the research students that I supervise and the students that I train through Fast Track Impact is that these guys report that actually it's these transferable skills that are the things that are the most useful to them, whatever career they go into. And actually, as a result of engaging with people outside academia, they discover a whole world of alternative, often more exciting, interesting, and lucrative career options that they actually end up going into because of the connections and the relationships they make as they reach out and make their research relevant. And for those who do go into academia, yeah, you do papers and hopefully a bit of a track record and funding to get that prestigious job. But actually having also got impact to your name can enable you to stand out from the crowd and demonstrate that you can do more than just be an amazing researcher. So I think it is incredibly valuable, incredibly important. It doesn't need to detract from your PhD. You can do this in a fairly small amount of time, no matter what your supervisor might tell you. So I'd encourage, go out there and find out what could you do to add that extra value to your early research.
If you had to choose one piece of advice for researchers who want to increase the impact of their research, what would that be?
So I think I would sum up a piece of advice up in a single word. That word is the word that I would use to sum up my last book, Fast Track Impact, and everything that we do as a company, my whole career, my ethos. That word is empathy. It is about putting yourself in the shoes of the people who might benefit from or use your research in some shape or form. So my advice to you aspiring researchers who want to make a difference is to work out how you can empathise with the people who might benefit from or use your research. Without empathy, impact is empty, it's meaningless, and could potentially go badly wrong. With empathy, you can genuinely connect with people and achieve lasting impact.